Why don't we stand and open a prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you and thank you, Lord. You are a loving Heavenly Father. You know every need of everyone that is here today, what we came in with, Lord, what we may be carrying. Father, my prayer today is that when they leave, it would be left at the cross of Calvary, paid for in full. When you said, it is finished, it was finished. So, Father, we ask that you would now be glorified in our praises, be worshiped in our thought, in our word, in our deed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Lord God. Lord, we love you this morning, Lord. We just come before you, Lord God. Thank you for the new hearts that you put into us, Lord God. Spiritually, Lord God, thank you for renewing us, Lord God. Lord, we need your presence here, Lord. We only need you, Lord God. So we lift you up right now, Lord God. We do believe by faith, Lord God. Our eyes one day will see what we believe in faith right now, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord God.
I believe in the blood of Jesus, washes white as snow. I believe in the power of the gospel, still makes a broken whole. I believe that the curse of sin was broken when they rolled away the stone. I believe, I believe, I believe. I believe in the blood of Jesus, washes white as snow. I believe that the power of the gospel still makes a broken whole. I believe that the curse of sin was broken when they rolled away the stone. I believe, I believe, I believe. As I bow before you, Lord, I will rise in confidence. I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. So no matter where I go, and no matter where I've been, I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. I believe that the walls will start falling when we fall down on our knees. I believe that the lame will go walking and the blind are gonna see. I believe that the gates of hell will tremble when the church begins to sing. I believe, I believe, yes, I believe. As I bow before you, Lord, I will rise in confidence. I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. So no matter where I go, and no matter where I've been, I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. Sing it to the sons, to every generation. Look at what the Lord has done. Sing it to the darkness when the light has come. Sing it to the nations. Look at what the Lord has done. Sing it to the daughters. Oh, sing it to the sons. Every generation, look at what the Lord has done. Sing it to the darkness, that the light has come. Oh, sing it to the nations. Look at what the Lord has done. Look at what the Lord has done. Before you, Lord, I will rise in confidence. I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. So no matter where I go, and no matter where I've been, I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. Sing it to the daughters, oh, sing it to the sons, to every generation. Look at what the Lord has done. Sing it to the darkness, and the light has come. Oh, sing it to the nations. Look at what the Lord has done. Look at what the Lord has done. As I bow before you, Lord, I will rise in confidence. I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. So no matter where I go, and no matter where I've been, I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in.
Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Lord God.
We have a Mother's Day testimony. Come on up. I'll hold this.
I am very proud to be the daughter of Marlene Love, and on this Mother's Day, I want to share why I am thankful for my mom. One reason I am thankful for my mom is because without her, I would not be here. One of the special things between me and my mom is that she makes me laugh. My mom is an extremely hard worker. She has shown me what the importance of work is and family to me And I'm thankful for my mom that I have a very good relationship with her. My mom, one which I can talk to her and come to her at any time. She protects me, makes me feel safe. She's an amazing cook and shows her love through her cooking. My mom is very loving. She has a big heart and enjoys helping others. In my opinion, if everyone had a mom like mine, they would feel as loved and as cherished as I do. My grandmother named my mom Love because when she was born, she was full of love and she radiated her name. My mom is the mom I hope to be one day, one who gives love and respects others. Mom, I want to thank you for being in my life, for helping me and being by my side.
Amen. Awesome. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Let's stand. We just want to prepare our hearts now as well for his word. And we have another exhortation for Mother's Day, but let's just give him all the praise and glory. How many would agree that any gratefulness we have from the next generation to look back, it is your healing. Never forget whose shoulders you stand on. Amen. Amen.
Early in the morning,
Praise God. Amen. I want you to just welcome Debbie Harris as she comes and just share some things from her heart as a mom. And I think most of you know that there's a verse in the Bible that says this, I bear the marks of following Christ, meaning there's been a price to pay. It hasn't all been easy. But when Paul the Apostle writes that, it means part of what God has done in our character in following him is priceless. Amen? Debbie, come on.
Happy Mother's Day, all the moms out there. So God has entrusted mothers with a great responsibility, but he does not leave us to fulfill it on our own. It's only through his grace, wisdom, and strength that we can accomplish his purposes. And I want to share a few abbreviated stories about godly mothers that raised their children to be world changers. The first two women are the grandmother, Lois, and the mother, Eunice, of Timothy. The Apostle Paul first met Timothy when he went to Lystra. Paul was impressed with Timothy's godliness and maturity and wanted him to join him in his travels. Timothy became a loyal friend and trusted companion to Paul. He was a defender of the faith against early heresies, and his character set an example of godliness. What had prepared Timothy for this assignment? Paul attributed Timothy's faith to his grandmother and mother, who had introduced him to the scripture, which did its work in Timothy. He became a man of the word because he was raised by women of the word. Next, I want to look at Elizabeth Newton. She was the mother of John Newton, who was born in 1725. He was a preacher, abolitionist, and hymn writer who wrote Amazing Grace. His mother suffered from TB and knew that her time with her son might be short, and so she determined to make the most of it. She taught him to read by the age of 4 and trained him in Reformed theology. She taught him to know God's existence and holiness and the gospel, that salvation is by grace through faith in Christ. She laid the foundation for his eventual conversion. She sowed the seeds of the word into his heart. She prayed and hoped that John would be called to the ministry. She died at the age of 27, 2 weeks before John's 7th birthday. His father remarried, but after having her own children, John's stepmother lost interest in him. When he was 11, his father, a seafarer, sent John to sea. John rebelled against God and committed atrocities. When John was eventually converted, he knew that it was inseparable from his mother's early training and her many prayers. And this is a quote from him when he looked back on his life. He said, though in process of time I send away all the advantages of these early impressions, yet they were for a great while a restraint upon me. They returned again and again, and it was very long before I could wholly shake them off. And when the Lord at length opened my eyes, I found a great benefit from the recollection of them. Elizabeth, he said, had stored my memory, which was then very retentive, with many valuable pieces, chapters, and portions of scripture, catechisms, hymns, and poems. So this story gives encouragement to sow the word in our children's heart. It will not return void. The next person is the mother of Hudson Taylor. He was born in 1832. His mother was Amelia, and she and her husband had dedicated him to the Lord before he was born. She is described as kind, gentle, and forbearing. She taught Bible classes for girls, and she and her husband led the children in family worship. Hudson had an early interest in spiritual matters and missionary work. When he was 15, he went to work in a bank where he first encountered people who mocked Christianity. He soon joined them and was drawn to making money. He lost interest in the Bible and prayer. When an eye problem developed, he had to resign from the bank and he returned home in a spiritual crisis. Amelia counseled him but determined that the best thing that she could do for him was to pray. During a trip away from home, she felt compelled to lock herself in her room and pray for hours until she believed that God had answered her. While she was praying, Hudson, who was at home, became bored and was looking for something to do. After finding no books in his father's library that interested him, he came across a tract titled Poor Richard. This led him to understand that Christ had done all that was necessary for salvation, and he committed his life to the Lord. Both he and his mother were praising God for Hudson's salvation, though miles apart. Hudson committed his life to missionary work, became a doctor, and went to China in 1853 at the age of 21. In the mission field, he was supported by his mother in prayer. He was spent 51 years in China, and because of his work, thousands of Chinese came to Christ. Hudson's story gives us encouragement that if sons or daughters stray from the Lord, to not despair, but to keep praying. Charles Spurgeon is the next person. He was born in 1834. His mother, Eliza, gave birth to 17 children, 9 of which died in infancy. Shortly after his birth, he lived with his grandparents until he was 4 or 5. Charles said that he was outwardly well-behaved, but he was aware of his deep depravity. He rebelled, revolted, and struggled against God. Some of his earliest memories were of his mother reading the Bible to all of the children, pleading with them to turn to Christ and praying for them. From age 10 to 15, he wrestled with the state of his soul. One Sunday, he was drawn to a Methodist chapel where he put his faith in Christ. He became known as the boy preacher and the prince of preachers, and he preached to millions. And here's a quote from him. In one of his early sermons, he said, "There once was a boy, a very sinful child, who hearkened not to the counsel of his parents, but his mother prayed for him, and now he stands to preach this congregation every Sabbath. And when his mother thinks of her firstborn preaching the gospel, she reaps a glorious harvest that makes her a glad woman. Never could it be possible for any man to estimate what he owes to a godly mother." Charles' story encourages us in the spiritual care of our children to teach God's word, pray for them, and plead for them to turn to Christ. The last example is the mother of Charles Spurgeon. He was born in Northfield, Massachusetts in 1837. His father died when he was 4, leaving his mother, Betsy, a single mother of 9 children under the age of 14. Her husband had died in debt, and the creditors took almost everything, even the firewood. Betsy was encouraged to break up the family and send the children to live with relatives, but she refused. She was committed to attending church and taught the children from the only books in the house, a Bible, a catechism, and a small devotional. She disciplined the children and kept a strict home. She plowed the ground and planted crops and sought work from nearby families. She spun yarn, weaved cloth, and made their clothes. Trust in God was her creed, and she always had a cheerful disposition in front of the children. From a young age, Dwight had to work to help to support the family. When he was 17, an uncle in Boston gave him a job in his shoe store. He was lonely and began attending a congregational church. His Sunday school teacher went to the shoe store to talk to Dwight about the state of his soul, and he was saved that day. At 19, he went to Chicago and started a mission that reached out to children and became the basis for a new church. After the Chicago fire of 1871, at the age of 37, he became a traveling evangelist, preaching to crowds around the world and leading multitudes to Christ. He always remained close to his mother, seeking her wisdom and counsel. She died at the age of 91, and at her funeral, Dwight said, "I think she is one of the noblest characters this world has ever seen." So I hope you find encouragement from these stories. These real life stories always encourage me of God using mothers in such a profound way, because God is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And just as he used those mothers, he can use mothers today. We serve a God that uses ordinary people to do miracles. We know these mothers were not perfect, because no one is. And I'm sure these mothers had no idea the impact their sons would have on the world, but they were faithful in doing the little things that God turned into great things. And even if our children are not destined to be world-renowned, every life has a ripple effect and touches more people than we will know in this life. Galatians 9:6 says, "Let us not lose heart in doing good, for in due time we will reap if we do not grow weary." Thank you.
It's just a little devotional. In the hallway, there are baby bottles representing our mission as a church to support your medical options and the medical, and this is a ministry that takes place to convince women to keep their babies. And in the culture we live in today, who would have ever thought that being for life from the moment of conception would be controversial? But we want you to make note, I think this is staying up right through to Father's Day. So you can take these and you just fill them with change, with dollar bills and whatever, but it reminds you why you're giving. And you just bring it back, right? They can just bring it back, put it back on the table, and we will collect them regularly. So that's the reason I have a baby bottle up here. It's no other. We're looking at the book of Titus, as we continue in Titus. And today I want to read from Titus 1, 5 through 9. So if you have that up there, that's good. Titus 1, just 5 through 9. And we're just going to proclaim God's word this morning. And we've had a full service. And I'm just asking that you ponder as we look at these verses. Once again, the advantage of going verse by verse through a book is that we understand it in context and we understand why these things are given. Titus was a missionary to the island of Crete, a very strong Greek island that had given up all aspects of morality. In fact, they were the leading edge of Greek society that was saying the best thing to do is to live and do whatever gives you pleasure and to throw off all moral absolutes as crude and unnecessary. It bears some relevance to today. Let's stand as we read these verses. Every section of the book of Titus gives us characteristics that Titus was to have in that church of believers to withstand a cultural pressure, but more than that, to transform it by seeing God do a mighty work. Let's read together. "For this reason I left you in Crete, that you should set in order the things that are lacking, and appoint elders in every city as I commanded you. If a man is blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of dissipation or insubordination, for a bishop must be blameless as a steward of God, not self-willed, not quick-tempered, not given to wine, not violent, not greedy for money, but hospitable, a lover of what is good, sober-minded, just, holy, self-controlled, holding fast the faithful word as he has been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and convict those who contradict." Amen. You may be seated. That's interesting that this verse is a transitional verse here in this first chapter. And it said, I want to send you down to straighten out and to complete what is unfinished and appoint elders in every town. Now, think about this for just a moment. Remember, the people from the island of Crete were at the day of Pentecost. When the Holy Spirit was poured out, there were many believers from the island of Crete. And it was amazing because it was so diverse. Evidently, these believers came from different parts of the island, from different towns in the island, and they went back. And here you have believers that are beginning to try to find one another, leading other people to Christ. By the time that Titus is written in the late 60s AD, 67 or so AD. We've had believers growing and the church growing in the island of Crete. However, they're lacking things. They're lacking good, solid teaching. And one of the main things they're lacking, as Paul the Apostle said, was examples of godly character. So if we look at all the ingredients we're going to look at in the book of Titus, what ingredients would be most important for a church to have in a culture throwing off all absolutes? What would a church need to have? And one of the key things the church needs to have are people of character. Character is critical. What is character? Character is the things that you do without thinking. Character is the way you are when no one's looking. Character are the habits you've built up in godliness and stability, sturdiness, the things that you would do to help one another. It's your example. The example of Christ in your life is more of greater prominence than gifts, than skills. You can have the greatest skill set, but people won't want to hire you. Why? Because you don't have character qualities that will make those skills useful. What good is it for someone to have great skills, but they never show up on time? They're always looking for more benefits than anything they put in. They want to get from someone rather than give. How do you work with someone like that? How can you go very far without character? The Bible lifts up character above gifts, above talents, above all those, above wealth. And the Bible says if you want to have something that will make a huge difference, don't think, well, gee, in a culture like this, we've just got to have media exposure. We've just got to have money. We just have to have flashy ministries. We have to have great gimmicks that can convince people to try to come in. We've got to become so much like the culture that they'll come in and stumble in and somehow find out. The Bible doesn't talk like that. The Bible says, have people who really are what they say they are. They have been through difficulty. You don't get character by an easy life. You don't get character unless you have someone that's willing to speak to you, to confront you. I remember I thought my father was one of the meanest people alive because he would look at me and he would confront me. And then I went out for basketball. And I met my coach. He was worse than my dad. In my mind, worse. But it was simply, he didn't care if everyone was listening. I remember the first time he said, Jehle, if you had an ounce of passion in that you desire, you would have had that rebound. And I was kind of like, shh, you just said that in front of the entire team. Can you just tell me that privately? No, but rough edges had to be worn off. You don't get character by having a bed of roses where there are no thorns. It doesn't happen this way. Character is not easy. It's difficult. It's in the trenches. And this character quality, they're listed here. Now, you could, each one of them, you could spend a time and a sermon on each one of them. But I just list them quickly and show you, what do we mean? Nobody is going to have all of these characteristics perfectly formed at any time. But it's a good checklist to say, what do we mean? I would dare say that we would need that today. In fact, I want you to understand something clearly about this as I go through the list. These character lists, what did Paul the Apostle actually mean by appointing elders in every city? See, there were already believers in every town throughout Crete. They had found one another. They were obviously meeting together. They could be identified. They may have been meeting in secret. They may have been meeting in different areas, conversing, but they needed individuals of character. You see, when he says appoint elders in every city, that was the last step of the process of how leaders are raised in the church. That was not the first step, it was the last step. He was not sending Titus into a town and saying, oh, you've got 8 people here in this small house church and you're moving and you don't have any leader. Okay, I'm just going to pray and just say, here's your leader. Okay, I just appoint you. Here's your leader. You'll see the word appoint is the word ordain. And this is the Greek phrase of the last possible step. See, God says throughout his word, and this is why you always interpret scripture from other scriptures. The Bible says it's very clear. This is how a leader is raised up. If you feel like God's going to use you in any way, then that's fine. But it's first, you see the hand of God working in your life. If God calls you, then your first focus is to follow him, not quickly get a following. You follow him. That's God's hand. And when other people see God's hand, they're drawn to it. Naturally, organically, without saying, yeah, if you come to my Bible study, I've got $100 bills for all of you. Now, that's the wrong way to draw people. What am I going to do, have $1,000 the next week? And then with inflation, I'm in trouble. No, you simply testify by your life that you're following the King of Kings, and if there's anything in that that other people want, they will naturally come. See, it's God's hand, then it's the people's hand reaching out. That's what the word vote means in the New Testament. It says the people saying, I consent, I agree, I like that, I consent to that. Because no one in the Bible is supposed to rule over anyone without the consent of the people. In fact, in verse 1 of the very book, it says, Paul the Apostle, I'm an apostle according to the faith of God's elect, according to the consent of the people who follow. Imagine what it's like in a church. People only follow because they consent. I've had people come up to me and say, how do you do this? How do you keep people going to church on Sunday? I said, what do you think I do? How do you do that? You know, threaten them if they don't show up? No, it has to be by consent. It's voluntary. But you see, you have God's hand, you have the people's hand, and that's what Titus saw. He saw, you can go to a room and you can have 10 people and they're all sitting in a circle and they're sharing, and only it'll take you about 10 minutes to find out who's the leader of those 10 people. Who have the people already said? You can tell. See, and this is the process, and then the leaders lay hands on the people. The hand of God, the hand of the people, and the hand of the leaders confirming it. Well, what were they confirming? Oh, this guy's got a nice business and he could probably support the future church, so let's choose him. That's not what they were looking for. That's good. It's not bad. If you're wealthy, praise God, just give it to him, use it for him. But that's not what they were looking for. They were looking for these things. This is what the people had. Now, whenever you lift up character qualities, it's difficult because we can all be in pain if we don't have them or we didn't have anyone in our life that emulated them. And that's possible. Some of us may not have had those kinds of examples. I go through this list and I can see more than 3/4 of them I didn't appreciate at the time. I said, that was my father. That was my father. I didn't admit it. That was my mother. That was it. I'm blessed. I had a phenomenal list. My mentors in college, the professors that went out of their way to help me, my basketball coach that led me to Christ and then mentored me. I was blessed. But I had to have these qualities. But never fear, because you can be the one bearing those qualities to somebody else, even if you didn't have it. So the first thing he's mentioning is being blameless, above reproach. Not perfect. Blameless doesn't mean I've never done anything wrong. It means in the public sphere, in other areas, you do not have the kinds of qualities that will bring you into reproach. If you're constantly stealing things, you're not above reproach. If you're habitually lying, you're not above reproach. If you're habitually promising, over-promising, and under-delivering, people aren't going to be drawn to that. It's talking about a character pattern here, not a perfection of never doing anything wrong. In fact, if you are blameless, when you do something wrong, you quickly admit it, you say, I'm sorry for that. And then that becomes an exception rather than the rule. So it's not a matter of being perfect at all. But blameless was a very critical thing. Because think of this, if you've got a small house church, it's under the persecution of the Roman Empire, and Rome has just recently taken over the island of Crete, and here are these churches, the last thing you want is somebody in that group that's already got a major issue with the authorities in the area of honesty, in the area of integrity, because then there's a reason for them to come in and find fault. So that's critical. But not only that, it says then, the husband of one wife. Now, this phrase has been debated throughout church history. We have all different kinds of, how do you interpret the husband of one wife? Where some people have said, well, what it means is you never should be married. And you're thinking, wait a minute, how does husband? Because there was a spiritual aspect in the fourth century that started husband of one wife simply means that a leader is married to the church. It's a mystical marriage. And therefore, because of that mysticism, they should never actually marry because they're married to the church. Well, that is a system that's been rejected. That interpretation has been rejected by most Protestant churches for various reasons, and they seem very obvious. Well, then does it mean that they have to be married? Does this mean that every person that's leading has to be married, so all single people are disqualified for every leading Bible studies? No, that's not the case at all. In fact, it doesn't mean that at all. Or someone said, well, married only once. That's what it means, even if the person has died. And or maybe they got divorced or something, so you can't. And then others are saying, well, if the divorce came before your conversion or after your conversion, that makes a difference, and you go through all these ideas. Well, if we would go back to the Greek and take it out of this in its original context, what it means is not all of those things. What it literally means is a one-woman man, meaning they're loyal to the covenant they have with the other person. You could switch it around because there were some female elders in churches that had no men that were ready to do that. And you could say, turn it around. You could say a one-woman man or a one-man woman. And you look at it and say, the faithfulness to the actual covenant that you have is critical. In other words, wouldn't you say this would be the obvious? If you can't keep your word, you're not bearing covenant. If you can't keep your vow, how could you be trusted? And this was critical. This is an aspect of character. Would you agree that if you're going to hire someone who keeps their word is going up top of the list? I'll meet you at 7:15. Now, today, you go and interview a businessman. You interview someone who runs a business. There are plenty of people that say, I'll meet you at 7:15 and don't show till 9:15. And others don't show at all. But they still want to be paid. They'll show up for the check or the digital download, they'll be upset. But you see, we have raised a culture in America by default and sometimes by design that want to get paid for nothing, that believe they're owed a check from where? Oh, the government. Where do they get their money? Let's not talk about that. That's lack of character. Would you agree that it's very attractive for you to hire somebody who keeps their word, who has faithfulness? But that is not all. It says, having children who are not accused of dishonoring their parents or riotous living. Well, not again, the same thing as, that means anyone who leads has to have children. No, that's not the case. But if they do have children, while their children are young, while they're living in the home, there's a character quality here, that the children generally honor their parents. Does it mean perfect children? Oh, forget it then. Then we're all cooked. Does it mean that the children are always going to be surrendered to Christ by the time they're 18? Not necessarily, but they're under the authority of parents. There is an aspect if your family can come against you. In other words, this will not come against you in the sense personally, but in other words, your character qualifies or disqualifies you. Character does, not gifting. God's not against gifting. He gives gifts. Gifts alone do not change cultures. Power, personality, charisma, all those kinds of things which we idolize from Hollywood, from athletes, from all the things we put on the highest pedestal where people would pay $5,000 to be in the same room with someone and then write 5 articles on what they wore. Or spend 25 minutes describing their mannerisms, and they know just how to. We give money, we pay homage to the very things left off this list. It won't change the culture. You're not going to do it that way. What changes the culture, what changes a society, what changes others is letting Christ do the work in you that changes your habit of living. It's who you are in the dark. It's who you are behind the scenes. Lest you ever think that I am perfect in every one of these. I have someone listening to this sermon. You know her name. But it works both ways. We're not out to pick at each other. It's the character of Christ that's so critical. Being a good steward is another on the list of resources, wisdom, right use of knowledge. What good is it to have a lot of knowledge? You have no idea when to say it and not to say it. That was me early on. If I knew it, it needed to be said. I learned the hard way. You know what? When someone said, you just need to keep your mouth shut. But why did God tell me? Why did God teach me this then? To give it at the right time. The right time is the time it comes into my brain and I see the person in front of me that really needs it. Well, you know, that's not a good recipe for ministry, is it, Dave? Anybody, you know, that's not a good habit to have. Because after you say it, sometimes you're running after before you want to catch it before it goes in the ear of the person. It doesn't work that way. It goes in too quickly. But you're a source of resources, not self-willed or filled with temper. If I had anger that's out of control, I can't control my anger. I have you come over to my house and I've got, you know, plaster patched up where I've put holes in the wall. I've got, the hammer is still hanging in the wall. Now take that out. Don't let them see that. I mean, I just had a bad day, that's all. And I call some people, come in, fix it up. Now, if it's out of control, that's a bad character trait. Then wait till it's under control. Are you all with me? See, you need to get this picture. The people that would be chosen to lead would be emulating the character qualities that the people believe are most important. And so what Paul, the apostle, said to Titus is, teach this to the believers. This was not taught to leaders. This was taught to the people. Teach what's most important, and then they'll know what's most important, and they'll obviously know who should lead and not lead them. It'll be very easy to do that, rather than just teach it. See, we've come so far in our own nation now that we're moving to the place where we're not even expecting people to operate by character. But we expect the people who are going to supersede and oversee them to somehow have that character. No, doesn't work that way. Americans are in for a rude instruction school. It's coming quickly. And it isn't this person, that person, the other. We get the government we resemble. And the point is, we're asking for greater and greater control. And the way to stop it is to build up greater and greater internal control. That's spiritually where we need to look at it. And that's why the Bible does this. Not greedy of wine or money. And if a person is unwilling to abstain from liquor, I'm not saying everything is a sin, but if they're unwilling to be that self-controlled as an example to not be a stumbling block to other people, folks. I said this at a public meeting one time, and I knew it was going to bring all kinds of anger. I said, how many would agree that we're in a massive, massive addictive culture? We've got a major epidemic on our hands. We've got people dying from drug addiction and from alcohol. And you ask any medical individual, and they'll say, alcohol is a drug. If you can't control it, how are you going to do it? We want character so opposite of the epidemic, it sets an example. You don't need substances to make you happy. You need God. That doesn't mean we condemn people who are addicted to substance. But there's an answer. There's an answer in God. And we're talking about this. One ingredient that's necessary to see a culture changed is character. Now, the word character, at its root means to scrape, to cut, and to squeeze into shape. Doesn't that sound inviting? To cut, to scrape. In fact, it comes from putting an anvil on a rock and putting in a character, a letter in there. If you go to some rock and monument, I like monuments, I go and I read them, and if they're carved in, it's one thing to have a plaque and it's cemented on, but to actually have it engraved in the rock, there's a lot of scraping going on. And that's who we are. You know the story. Michelangelo's staring at this lump of stone, and the guy says, what's wrong with you? What do you see? And he said, I see an angel. The person said, I see a lump of stone. He goes, okay. Soon I will cut away everything that doesn't look like an angel. That's what God does. Holy Spirit says, I see the image of my son in you. You've surrendered your life to Christ. You've given, I see the image of my son. I go, I don't see the image of your son. I see mess. I see habits that need to be broken. I see all kinds of stuff that's wrong with me. Well, that's okay, because the Holy Spirit says, all we're going to do is cut away everything that doesn't look like Jesus. That's a great way to say, a great time to say amen, even though it's extremely difficult to do so. And also the character quality of hospitality, to be hospitable, to be open, to have people not just in your home. Hospitable means the way you treat people. You welcome a new person. You welcome someone who's different, comes from a different persuasion than you do. You welcome a discussion. You welcome people in. Hospitable is very, very critical. No church will grow that is not hospitable. People can tell right away, oh, I don't fit in. I can tell, you know, they could come to our church, and now it's a little different, but they come to our church and say, I can see a lot of these people know each other, and they've been here for a long time, which is another way of saying they're a little bit older. And they've been here for a long time. They know the ropes. I'm not sure I fit in. Hospitality changes all that. That's mercy. That's compassion. And the Bible says that's critical. These are critical qualities. Hospitality. Folks, we'll be challenged to be hospitable, even to people that disagree with us. You know, you don't do that. I've read the diaries of the pastors who have all kinds of people who picket their churches, who come and railing at individuals who walk out of the service, come into the service, are furious. And the churches that are able to handle it have individuals that can go out and interchange with them, and even though one person is screaming, they don't react at all. They don't react that way. I've seen it both ways. I've seen it in government halls. When the Christians are jawing it out on one side and the other people on whatever cause are jawing it out on the other, and the Christian says, I felt good today, and I'm thinking, I don't feel good at all. That's not the way to deal with it. Hospitality is different. It says, lovers of that which is good, sober, to know when to be serious, justice, a sense of justice, holiness, temperate, reserved, knowing when to be quiet. That was one of the qualities that gets chipped on me on a regular time. It's not always wise to speak. I remember, I don't know if Charlene would remember, but I remember I was in a situation, it was very difficult, it was a debating atmosphere. Oh, I love those atmospheres. And I called her up, so it had to be in the realm of cell phones. Called her up on the way home and I said, you'll be so proud of me. She goes, okay, what? She said, there's a little bit of caution there. This is what happened in the meeting, and I didn't say a word. And of course, then she would say, well, you have to work on your humility, but still, that's okay. That's good. But the point is, it was huge for me. May not be for you. You go, no, the other way, if I ever said anything, it would be a major thing. But for me, reserved, to learn to be reserved, that's huge. See, these are character qualities. And the best character quality that overshadows it all is the last verse. Holding fast the word of God. Keeping the word of God central. How do we know what's a good and bad character quality? I've had people argue. I said, well, the Bible does say there's a time for righteous anger. We can talk about that in its context. But the idea is, Well, what's wrong with that? I just gave them a piece of my mind, and boy, they deserve far worse. Okay, but what's our standard with what's good character, bad character? It's the Word of God. It's what God says. The most important characteristic for any of you to look up to anyone else is someone who says, if the Word tells me I'm wrong, then I'm wrong. Lord, help me to be loyal to His Word, to hold it forth. So what is the mission of the Christian life? But think about this. What was Titus doing by, what was Paul the Apostle doing by highlighting this? How could you actually say, what are you going to put in the island of Crete? What are you going to put there? You're going to put people who love God, who love other people, who exhibit character, and you're going to plant them in the middle of a culture that has thrown off all absolutes and is actually exalting the fact that everything is pleasing in your own eyes. Whatever is pleasing in your eyes is right, and nobody should ever come against it. If it feels good to you, then it is your truth. But I would just clue you in. No society can live by that premise. It will just tear itself apart because my truth is different than your truth. Now, how do we settle the fact that you disagree with me and you say, this is the truth? I say, nope, this is the truth. Oh, well, it's just for you. Why don't you go to your house? I'll go to mine. It doesn't work that way when all of a sudden you're in a society. How can we do that? What if I like killing and you don't? Well, you don't when it's killing you. How does that ever work? It's going to have to be loving God and loving His Word. Amen? That's the key.
Radiate His passions, then ablaze with holy love. To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission, the spring from which our service overflows across the street or around the world. The mission's still the same. Proclaim and live the truth in Jesus' name. To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission, the spring from which our service overflows across the street. Or around the world, the mission's still the same. Proclaim and live the truth in Jesus' name. It's the heartbeat of our mission, the spring from which our service overflows across the street or around the world. The mission's still the same. Proclaim and live the truth in Jesus' name.
To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission. To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of.
Amen. Thank you, Bob. Let's all stand. Can you sense the move of God? You know, I was contemplating this morning, sometimes I just sense, how do I want to close in prayer? And the Lord kind of gave me this little blip of something. And he said, the weather. You know, we turn the TV on and listen to the weather. And that weatherman has to rely on what's already happening someplace else. Today it's sunny. Tuesday the rain's coming. The winds are coming. Well, today I want to be a spiritual weatherman. The move of God is coming. The move is going to sweep across this land. I sense it. I feel it. I just can't get by without it. So let's just go before the Lord. We close this morning. There's just so much to be thankful for, so much to be grateful for. Often some of the songs that we sang earlier, there's no stopping God. He is on the move. He is always on the move. He is perpetual, perpetual motion. The kingdom of God is always expanding. It'll never, ever be stopped. We need to rest in that. We need to allow him to be the battle maker. It's his battle, not our battle. He's chosen us to be a part of the kingdom of God here on earth. I think of Roe v. Wade. It's just the beginning of the battle, folks. It's like a hornet's nest that's in the corner, and you go and kick it. That's when the hornets get angry. That's when the enemy now is going to be pulling out all the stops. We're going to be the answer to those that want to abort their children. Are we willing to step up to be that answer? Are we willing to take in those? Are we willing to finance groups, ministries that'll be the answer? That's the only way the battle will be won, is if the church becomes the church. So let's just go before the Lord as we close this morning. Father, we just come before you this day, Lord Jesus. acknowledging you as sovereign, as king, as the mighty warrior over all. You have defeated the enemy, O God. The blood of Jesus has defeated the foe. There is no resurrecting of that foe. He is gone. He is defeated. We walk in victory this day. We walk in the word, in the blood of Jesus Christ. And Father, we thank you for that this day, Lord God. And Father, I cause a stirring now in this body, not only in this place, but across this land, across this world, Lord Jesus, that the ecclesia would arise, that the church would become the church, Lord Jesus, that you have destined, that you have called her to, and that you will fulfill it until the day of your son coming again. So Father, we just thank you this day. We glorify in your name, in your name only, for there is no other name but Jesus that one can be saved. God bless you as you go, in Jesus' mighty name, amen.